May you enjoy. A quick thank you to the T5 peeps. Bob the Dragon, Data Magnet, Cat Crab Lobster, Duck Machine, Try Again 95, Estrella the Dreamer, Mezik, Budic Joel, German Chemist, Casper Arnholtz, and Chaos to Must. Thank you very much. Soldiers and Their Toys, written by Lostform. Corporate Post watched his fire team with a wary eye as they prepared for the mission. Each member of the squad was getting ready for the impending assault.
Lord, please, let this mission go smoothly and make sure that Specialist Kellogg doesn't do anything stupid, he prayed silently.
Specialist Kellogg was busy debasing his assault suit, merely little more than a fancy EVA suit. Corporal Post had to just shake his head at the peace symbol on the specialist was drawing on his chest plate.
You know, the captain catches you doing that, he'll have your ass. Especially since even General Mills will be in attendance with the Allied races and their ambassador. Everyone is watching to make sure that we impress our new allies. Not to see how royally you can screw up, Corporal Post observed while thinking, maybe that'll finally free me from the screw-up.
Don't worry about it. I already took care of the squad's carers. The captain won't see it, and I'll clean it up after this dog and pony show, Specialist Kellogg replied, never even looking up from whatever else he was drawing.
What do you mean? The corporal asked, already knowing he probably didn't want to know.
That new guy and I made sure that any attempt to hook into our cameras got rerouted.
Just trust me, Corporal, Private Kellogg replied with a smile.
Corporal Post just shook his head. Let's go along and check on the other three. Kellogg could screw up a wet dream, so no way he rerouted the cameras. This is Private Trix's first mission. Best make sure his suit will even seal. Specialist Graham and Toucan have done this enough, then I don't have to worry too much about them.
As the corporal approached, he was just in time to see his senior specialist sending a private to ask his squad leader for some gig line. Shaking his head, he couldn't help but think, no wonder they call this team the Fruit Loops.
Captain Crunch watched the skeletal assault pods race towards their targets from the drones launched at the same time.
Well, I gotta give the flyboys this. That was almost too smooth.
Just beyond the engagement range of the Dovac cannons, he had seen a brief flash of the assault pods firing. The ships that had carried them had fired off some torpedoes at the same time. Captain Crunch had been happy to see Dovac point defense was distracted from his boys. Behind him, Captain Crunch could hear General Mills briefing the collected Allied generals and ambassadors.
I still can't get used to all of these aliens. They may have better technology, but they are idiots in a fight.
The humans were new to the Alliance, having been contracted only because the Allies were struggling against the Dovac. None of these races were as warlike as the reptilian aliens. The best Captain Crunch could do was think of them as birds, the bugs, and the bears.
I still can't believe the diplomatic corps was even communicating with them. Those oversized cranes have too many apostrophes in their name and just talk in whistles. The bugs have names that sound like a spoon in the garbage disposal, and a language that matched. Those oversized teddy bears, those little bear-like McFuzzy somethings, are about the only ones I can kind of understand.
Captain Crunch thought as he listened to something that sounded vaguely like a one-man band falling down a 3,000 steps of the Burj Khalifa. Captain Crunch realized the human ambassador and General Mills had approached him. Turning to face them, the ambassador stated,
Captain, we are going to share this historic feed with the Alliance. We want to pipe it out to show the value of us as allies,
the human ambassador stated. Before Captain Crunch could even reply, General Mills cut him off.
Do it, Captain. It's already cleared.
With a crisp yes, sir.
Captain Crunch turned back to the feed. He was noticing an odd behavior, but the General's command had been clear.
Why does every surveillance drone I activate appear to be focused on Corporal Post's squad?
Knowing there wasn't much he can do about it with all the eyes on him, he silently prayed.
Please, don't let these idiots do anything too stupid.
General Mills heard the McFurry something ambassador gasp.
I still can't believe these soldiers volunteered to do this.
Do they know the risks? The general spared him a glance while cursing the human ambassador for sending the space care bear to watch over his shoulder.
Ambassador, I assure you they are all volunteers. Captain Crunch picked each of them personally for this mission.
The confused expression on the creature almost made the general laugh.
I hope I don't accidentally call this thing Braveheart Lion,
they quietly thought as he looked at the spluttering bear-like alien. The cockroach-looking creature next to it started to say something, but was apparently distracted by a feed on the screen. As General Mills looked towards the screens, he could see the Dovac point defense systems were starting to put an impressive light show. The Dovac had almost finished destroying the torpedoes, but seemed unaware of the assault pods. General Mills could only imagine the confusion the Dovac were likely experiencing as to why the human fleet was sitting at range. Revan, the commander of the Dovac warship, the Hunter, watched as the alien warship had unleashed a barrage of torpedoes upon his ship.
These new ships are already showing more strategic knowledge than these allies usually do. The use of a picket line and skirmishes was unexpected, he thought as he watched the skirmish line regroup with the fleet. I wonder if this is the new race I heard the prey races had recruited, he guffawed. I almost hope they have a better plan than that if they are to be a challenge.
Throughout the command deck, he could hear his officers laughing at his post. Still, deep down he felt a nagging doubt.
Surely, their allies had warned them that we would shoot down those torpedoes. The range was too far for them to have any hope of getting past the point defense.
Even as he was thinking about this, his sensor officer suddenly shouted,
Sire, we are picking up a strange signal near us. I think it's a drone. The ship's AI has been able to interpret it. It's an image signal.
Brevin felt a chill run through him.
Put it on screen.
As he gave the command, the hollow display shrunk down to a smaller display size and was replaced by a grainy image. On it, four dark shapes appeared to be floating towards the outside of the ship. Just as Revan was about to say something, the camera zoomed in on one of the figures. He was puzzled by what appeared to be a large yellow circle with what almost appeared to be a face drawn on it. With a sense of dread, he wondered, why are they floating in the void? Turning to his second in command,
Sidious, what are they doing? Why do they have soldiers floating in the void? Did we hit one of their ships?
He had thought that he'd watched the battle carefully, but perhaps one of the ships in the line had struck a skirmisher. Revan suddenly was getting a sick feeling. Given the size of their fleet, why are they just watching? None of this would have worried him had he thought that one of those peacenik McCloysters was in charge. But these aliens were still unknown. As his reptilian eyes focused on the displays, he listened for his second's response.
Sire, they appear to be landing troops on our ship, he reported.
The second was obviously confused by this approach. It was common knowledge that boarding an enemy ship was tantamount to suicide. As he watched on screen, the black armored form with a smiley face on its back ignited its handheld plasma beam. Feeling a sense of dread, he yelled,
They are attacking our ship!
A quiet voice of his second responded,
How could we respond, sire?
Revan realized with a sense of dread that there would probably be less than 5 suits on the ship for traversing the void, and those were built for maintenance. Worse, nothing on the ship was designed to shoot along the hull. As his crew looked at him, he couldn't help but think,
What sort of insane species is this? This isn't how you fight in space.
Secured on the hull with his mag boots, Corporal Post had to take a minute to appreciate the chaos he and his brethren were causing. Keying up his squad,
Look up, boys! They decided to give us a light show.
As he surveyed the space around him, he couldn't resist a maniacal smile. The lizards were firing off every weapon they could, randomly, in the hopes to stop the now obvious boarders, as their ships drifted out of formation. They were raining fire upon each other in their desperation.
Let's light them up, he yelled with glee, as the plasma blade in his suit's glove lit up, extending its red cutting blade. He marveled at how it reflected off the ship around him. He looked to the side in time to see Private Trix plunge his blade into the wall of the vessel near himself, resulting in an almost explosive escape of pressurized gas. Oh, crap! The private yelled as he lost his footing, drifting almost a foot off the deck before he used his suit's small jets to get back on the deck. Careful, Cherry. Hate to lose you already, Specialist Graham yelled. Where's Kellogg? Was as far as Corporal Post got before he suddenly heard Specialist over the radio. Psst, bam, bam, was coming from the radio. Looking over, Corporal Post realized that Specialist Toucan and Kellogg were cutting away at an obvious turret. With a sigh, he keyed the mic. Damn it, Kellogg! They aren't lightsabers! They are plasma blades, and keep your sound effects in your own damn head! He didn't want to admit it, but even he couldn't help but admire the way Kellogg pretended to be using the Force. Kellogg had finished cutting through the base of the turret and managed to show off an actor-grade Force push as he pressurized Hull rocketed into space. Shaking his head, he found himself joining in on the fun. Corporal Post had to go ahead and say, "You're still no Jedi, more like a freaking Jar Jar character." "That's Darth Jar Jar to you, Corporal," came Kellogg's reply. Captain Crunch should have felt great, being ecstatic even at the success of his boarding troops. And were it not for whatever system glitch was keeping the camera focused on the Fruit Loops, might have been. He quickly clicked through cameras 10, 11, and 12. He was getting desperate to find something that showed him anyone other than Specialist Kellogg. Instead, behind him, all he could hear was the Allied ambassadors hammering the human diplomats and General Post with questions. He could almost feel the general's glare on the back of his uniform as he again tried to change the camera and microphone feed. As he looked back, he again tried three more cameras. As cameras 13, 14, and 15 came up, he was again treated to the three more perspectives of Kellogg's graffiti-covered suit. Many of the Dovac ships were visibly losing gases into the void. Debris was raining from the ships in a steady stream. The humans on the hulls, emboldened by the success, were starting to cut into the ships. The video feed from the squad, though, was not helping. Their sound effects and hand motions had convinced the Allied aliens that the humans had a hidden secret telekinetic power. Glancing over his shoulder towards General glaring at him, he cycled three more cameras. As he looked back at the screen to see Kellogg's now familiar suit, the captain grimly thought, I wonder if getting force-choked would be as painful as what's going to happen when we leave this room. Specialist Kellogg was ecstatic. He was living the dream. Never in his wildest dreams did he think that he would get to live the power fantasy of his childhood. But here he was, on the hull of an alien ship equipped with an honest-to-God lightsaber. And it actually worked. Looking around, he realized his squad had already made short work of the priority targets and even caused the main drive of the lizard ship to go offline. He couldn't help but think, I shouldn't have taken out the squad's cameras. It would have been so awesome to have some photos of this. He moved across the lizard ship, no longer the proud warship he had originally landed on. He spotted a crew hatch. With an evil smile, he had an idea. Using his suit's jets, he launched himself at the remaining 20 feet towards the hatch, carefully timing the activation of his saber. He managed to neatly cut the hinges as he landed and yelled, Force! Push! As all of his squad looked his way, he could only imagine how impressive they were to see his hand movement appearing to bring the hatch now rocketing into space as he acted the role. Over the mic, he heard the others in his squad cheer as they emulated his false powers. Damn, I should have kept our cameras working. Footage of this would have been sick. Again, crossed his mind. Now it was time to coop to grace. Moving towards the now open hatch, he did his best impersonation of his favorite character from those classic movies. General Mills couldn't see how his situation could get worse politically. Their allies were completely unnerved at the video feed they were getting,
And no matter what the captain did, the idiot somehow never managed to change it. To top it all off, no matter how much he tried to explain that these humans were pretending, each glance at the screen just made the situation worse. As the specialist covered in graffiti proceeded to yell force push and pretend to throw a door, one of the living Care Bears gasped. The bugs and the birds had long since fallen completely silent. He could only imagine the upcoming diplomatic fallout. The slack-jawed look of the Care Bear was enough to make him glad that he wasn't in the diplomatic corps. Just as the general was rubbing his brow and thinking, can't get any worse. Over the comms of the entire ship, Specialist Kellogg came over the feed in a heavy mechanical breathing.
I am Darth Vader, you bitches, and I am your father.
Gregat of the McClosages wrinkled his bear-like face in confusion. Looking at the Clackabert and the Spilectalella ambassadors, he could see that they shared his feelings. He had tried to communicate through the translator to the human diplomats and the general to get clarification how those soldiers on the screen could push things in the void without touching them. How they were able to handle simple scraping tools as though they were weapons that they had training with for years. And most importantly, how did they have soldiers related to the Dovahks? Whatever the reason, it was quickly becoming apparent the diplomats and general would not provide the answers he sought. Turning towards Luke, the human ambassador, Master Luke, can you explain what we are seeing? Beside him, he knew his fellow diplomats were now looking towards Luke. All were expecting an answer. He felt a wave of relief as Luke gave him a positive smile that he'd learned about and responded, Greg, I know this must be confusing and I hope this does not hurt our relationship. I've just got an authorization to share an entire documentary. Have you ever heard of the Jedi? End of story. And that, my friends, concludes this video. I hope that you